Okay, so let's get started. It's a great pleasure to introduce Peter Achinstein, one of the great figures of philosophy of science of the 20th and 21st centuries. He's written a lot of books on evidence and other topics. His book, Waves and Particles, won the Lakatos Prize. And he's the founding director of the Center for Philosophy and History of Science at Johns Hopkins. And he's going to talk today about Maxwell's scientific method. Peter.
Okay, thank you, Carl. I guess I'll begin with a story, why not? You and your dog are walking in the woods. I'm no artist, believe me. And if you've seen this, don't give it away. Let's see, no, I want it the other way around. We got it, I think. And this, and something like that. And you're walking in the woods and you see this thing with your dog. And you say, what's that? And the thought suddenly hits your head that it's a bear climbing a tree. But you're not sure, you know. So you kind of edge around here, and it moves a bit. But you then decide to send your dog around, because if it is a bear, you know, you don't want to be around there. So you send your dog out there, and of course that's the worst thing you could have done, because the dog starts barking at the bear. And then the bear climbs down the tree very quickly at you, because you're the owner of the dog. This brief story is my caricature of William Hewell in the 19th century. And it's my caricature of William Hewell because Hewell says you got some phenomena here, right? Some puzzling phenomena, and you want to understand what's going on. You want to explain the phenomena. And so the first thing you'd have to do, which he called colligation, is to apply some concept that the mind supplies to explain what's going on here. So the concept you come up with, maybe, is bear climbing a tree. And that's the discovery stage of science, according to Hewell. But you're no scientist if you just, you know, do that, if you just dream up a hypothesis, which is very difficult to do. In fact, Hewell thinks it's the most important part of science. The rest is more automatic, I think, for Hewell. But it's the great geniuses who think up the bear and the tree hypotheses. I mean, his example was not, of course, that. It was Kepler thinking up the elliptical orbit for Mars, but a similar thing. And the next stage is, that's the discovery stage, he called it. The next stage is testing. And testing consists in, you know, doing the things that you ordinarily would think, showing what this thing can explain, making predictions. So your prediction is maybe that if you send the dog around there, he'll come running back and say, yes, it's a bear. Of course, you don't expect the bear to come running back either, but that's what happened. And this is the way you test. And the more varied the phenomena that you can predict and explain, so on, what he calls consilience, the more tested the theory is until it becomes absolute certainty. So this is a simplification, a caricature, perhaps, of William Hewell. How many of you have read Hempel's book on Philosophy of Natural Science? It's a very famous old textbook, and do you remember what he began with? A similar example, except this is from Ignaz Semmelweis. Remember who was a doctor in Vienna in the mid-19th century, okay? And Semmelweis was at the Vienna General Hospital dealing with the following problem, that there were two maternity wards in the hospital. And one, the women had a much higher incidence of what was called childbed fever, and were dying from it. at that time. And Semmelweis had to do what Whewell described as, making up various hypotheses. In other words, conceptualizing the data in different ways. And Semmelweis actually struggled quite a bit because he had one hypothesis that in one ward the priest walked to give the last rites to a dying patient, which was psychologically very damaging to the women in that maternity ward, and hence was causing their childbed fever. Until he finally hit on the, and then he tested that by preventing the priest from walking there, but the incidence of childbed fever remained the same in the more infected ward. And so finally, the story goes that he thought of the hypothesis that, well, the what's happening in this case is that the medical students who are doing autopsies are doing autopsies just before they went into the first ward, but not the second. And it's the infectious material that they were carrying without washing their hands properly. It's the infectious material they were carrying which is causing this. And so he tested that, did the consilience and prediction thing and so on. And that turned out to be right. And so Hempel says, there are just like Whewell, there are two stages to scientific inquiry. The first is the discovery stage, and the second is the testing stage. And that's what science is all about. My second story is pertains to the early 1980s when Steven Weinberg, Nobel winner, of course, in physics, came to Johns Hopkins to give the Briquity lecture. And I attended it. And Weinberg, it was more autobiographical than anything else, he talked about string theory. And he wanted to explain, what he was doing, why he went into string theory. He said, that was a hot theory at the time, it still is to some extent. He took a year off to learn the math necessary to participate in string theory. He talked as if he was just very excited about his work in string theory. And of course, he wrote a book about this, a popular book, Dreams of a Final Theory. And he said it would be 50 to 100 years before the theory could be tested. The energies required would be much too high. But nevertheless, it was worth doing. And more recently, I should say what happened at the end. In the discussion period, it was amazing to me because this was a lecture for physicists. And it was a tremendous division between two kinds of physicists. One, the theoretical physicist said, yeah, this is interesting stuff. The experimentalists were down on him in a very difficult way, saying that this is not physics, it's not science, it's metaphysics. You can't test the darn thing, and you don't even know how to test it. What would test it? So you've got Whewell's, perhaps some of Whewell's, a colligation stage or Hempel's discovery stage, but nothing of the testing stage, and that's what we do in philosophy. So I was very taken with this, and Weinberg didn't seem to mind. He won the Nobel Prize. He did his physics. He didn't seem to mind. I wonder why he didn't seem to mind. The same thing with Brian Greene, who came last year to Hopkins to give a special lecture on string theory, in which he was much more descriptive of what string theory was doing and the problems and so on. And he put up on the board, various problems, one of which was there's no test for the theory at all. And there won't be one. Same, similar thing, and he didn't seem to be worried about it. And the guy sitting next to me was a graduate student in physics, and he said, we don't teach string theory in our department because it's philosophy, not physics. I was really taken with that. All right, that's the end of my stories. And I want to start with Maxwell now. because Maxwell, in the 19th century, was interested in various problems, obviously. In 1855, Maxwell wrote a paper called On Faraday's Lines of Force. I mean, probably his first major great paper. It's a big one. It's, I think it's 72 pages, something like that. And I'm going to quote some things. I'm going to quote some things from my book, but not the things that I wrote, the things that Maxwell wrote. The question that Maxwell was raising in this paper, as in several other papers he wrote later, both in electricity and on molecular kinetic theory, the question is was this for Maxwell: what do you do if you don't have a theory to explain the phenomena? Or even if you have a theory, but you can't prove it, what do you do? Well, if he had read Descartes' Problems of Philosophy, Descartes says at a point, if you can't intuit the correct answer, or if you can't deduce the answer to your problem from the intuitions that you start with, then you don't go any further. You turn to another problem where you can solve it. And Newton effectively said the same thing. Of course, he rejected Cartesian intuitions and so forth. But Newton said, his official doctrine, though he violated it many times, his official doctrine was that, look, hypotheses have no place in experimental philosophy. Right? That was what he says, and hypotheses are propositions that you cannot deduce from the phenomena, that you cannot derive from the phenomena using his four rules plus, you know, mathematics. And so you don't speculate at all. You don't do that. And of course, Newton did it, but that was his official doctrine. Now, Maxwell, I think, was more interesting in these regards than Whewell or Hempel. And Maxwell said, look, there are lots of things you can do, even if you don't have a theory. And he began with certain well-known phenomena in electricity and magnetism. And what he said in 1855 on the paper on Faraday's Lines of Force is, I'm not going to present any theory in this paper. I don't have one. Nobody has one. I mean, nobody has one that I'm interested in. Yet I'm going to do something with regard to the known facts, to the phenomena, to the data. I'm going to make them understandable to you in a certain way. Without speculating, without hypotheses. And how's he going to do that? That's the question. So let me quote from Maxwell, 131 here. He says, toward the beginning of his paper, he says, the first process, therefore, in the effectual study of the science must be one of simplification and reduction of the results of previous investigation to a form in which the mind can grasp them. The results of this simplification may take the form of a purely mathematical formula, where you have a formula in which you don't indicate what the symbols really mean, physically speaking. Or the alternative is between this purely mathematical way of looking at things and what he calls a physical hypothesis. In the first case, we entirely lose sight of the phenomena to be explained, and though we may trace out the consequences of given laws, we can never obtain more extended views of the connections of the subject. If, on the other hand, we adopt a physical hypothesis, We see the phenomena only through a medium and are liable to that blindness to facts and rashness and assumption which a partial explanation encourages. We must therefore discover some method of investigation which allows the mind at every step to lay hold of a clear physical conception without being committed to any theory founded on the physical science from which that conception is borrowed, so that it is neither drawn aside from the subject in pursuit of analytical subtleties, that's the mathematical thing, nor carried beyond the truth by a favorite hypothesis. In order to obtain physical ideas without adopting a physical theory, we must make ourselves familiar with the existence of physical analogies, which is what he's going to do in this paper. By the way, when I started getting interested in Maxwell in the late 1980s, I went to the university library at Cambridge University, and I was told that all of Maxwell's correspondence are in about 6 or 7 or 8 shoeboxes. Which shoebox did I want? And I said, I don't know. Give me them all. And so they really spent, you know, quite a time loading them on a big car. These were big things. And I started going through his correspondence. Now, of course, this was in the day before the typewriter. So it's all handwritten stuff. And it's all, you know, mid-19th century stuff on, you know, acid-filled paper. Okay, so it's falling apart. They did not demand that I use gloves, and the only request they made is don't use a pen, but I could use a pencil. Okay, and I was amazed I could get this far, but I did, and I came across a letter written to Maxwell. I forget what year it was, in the 1860s. Early, and I think he was a professor at the University of London at that time. And the letter was written by some, I guess we might call him a dean or something, at Cambridge University. And it said, Dear Maxwell, the first paragraph was, we are establishing the Cavendish Laboratory at Cambridge University, and we are establishing the Cavendish Professorship at the Cambridge University. This is a kind of letter you love to get. Paragraph number 2, we have offered this position to Lord Kelvin, who has thought about it but declined. Number 3, would you be interested in this new position?
Well, then can you suggest someone else?
What? yeah, that's a good one. And so, And Maxwell was not amused by this. I mean, Kelvin was a good friend of his, perhaps the senior man, but Maxwell was the true genius. And Maxwell wrote back very coldly. He didn't even thank this functionary for writing the letter. His main question was, how much teaching will I have to do? See how we live in the modern age here. And of course, he did take the job. He was the first Cavendish professor of physics at Cambridge. But his life was very short, so he didn't last a long time there. Maxwell then says, look, what I'm going to do in this paper is try to help you understand some of the known laws of electricity and magnetism. I'll try to organize them in a certain way. And I'm going to subject this to 3 conditions that you will have to, I will try to abide by. And he does this in this paper, and I'm going to talk about 2 more papers where he develops 2 other methods of proceeding. This he calls the method of physical analogy. And the idea, the first idea is that it's got to be physical. You've got to give me a physical picture of what's going on. The second idea is that you've got to spell it out. Not just give me a few ideas. Maxwell was asked to write an article on molecules for the Encyclopedia Britannica. And there he's writing for a more general public, and he says, let me give you an analogy between molecules in a gas and a swarm of bees. Think about that. Now, he didn't spell this out, but he didn't need to. Okay, the bees are roving around, you know, in a enclosed space, and that's the way the molecules are doing and so on. But in this paper, no. He's doing real physics, he thinks, and he wants to spell this whole thing out so that you'll get, you know, a thorough idea of what's going on. And the third thing, he wants to express it mathematically, but the mathematical things, the equations that he introduces, will all have a physical interpretation that he makes very clear. So what does he do? He says, and he wants to make sure it's an analogy which you don't know about, okay? In fact, it's an imaginary thing. He constructs what he calls an imaginary fluid flowing through tubes. And the imaginary fluid is the analog of the electric current. Okay. And then he starts with Faraday's lines of force, which you've seen, you know, around a magnet. But that's not three-dimensional. So he wants to give you a three-dimensional thing with tubes. And you can vary the thickness of the tube and thereby vary the velocity of the tube. And the velocity of the fluid will represent the magnitude of the force, the electrical force. And he sets it up this way. He sets it up so that on the one side you have the electric field. Here's the electric force at a point in the field is represented by the velocity of the of fluid at a point in the fluid. And a particle of positive electricity is represented by a source of this imaginary fluid. And the electrical potential at a point is the pressure of the fluid at a point. And then he sets it up so that Coulomb's law of attraction among forces, it's an inverse square law, will be satisfied in the fluid as well. Then he works out all kinds of consequences, mathematical consequences, some of which are interesting to this thing. And he does this for 72 pages. Okay. And he actually works out some solutions for, you know, in the case of the fluid, what's going to happen. And you could apply that to the electric field if you like. And you know, this gives you an understanding, he thought, of what's going on in electricity. Well, how? How does it do that? How does it do that? One way to understand, here are the data right here. See? And one way to understand these data is to conceptualize them, like Hewell said, to organize them into a bear. I mean, it doesn't mean your hypothesis is true. It's just one way to understand the thing, which you then have to test. Okay. And that's what Hewell says we do all the time. And Maxwell agrees that, you know, I can conceptualize the data in various ways. Doesn't mean I'm doing it correctly or that it'll lead to something interesting, but this is one way of doing it. One way of conceptualizing the data is the way we did it here, say, well, it's a bear. Another way to conceptualize the data, and that's the route that Maxwell takes, is to use an analogy. Saying, well, it's like this. So that's, you know, his bee analogy, the swarm of bees, is like what it is to be a gas composed of molecules swarming around. Okay? That's another way of understanding things, and that's the route Maxwell takes. And he thinks that by drawing this analogy, you will be helped in understanding, in this case, the real law, known experimental laws of electricity. Okay? And as I say, he obviously takes this very seriously because he spends 72 pages on it. Okay. So this provides a physical way of understanding the phenomena. And this is the crucial point for Maxwell, a physical way of understanding the phenomena without knowing what's causing the phenomena. He is not presenting to you what you would call a theory of electricity, whether electricity really is a fluid of some kind, whether it's composed of particles of some kind. He's not playing that game. He's just saying, I can organize the data in this way, and this may help you, you know, understand these laws.
Okay. There are other advantages that Maxwell, let me see if I can, if there's any other. Yeah, so he spends some time trying to admit to you, tell you that this is not a physical hypothesis. He is not. This is a purely imaginary fluid which he's constructing in his mind for the purposes of the paper. You don't know any more about what's causing electricity after you read the paper than you did before. Okay. Now, he also says that there are some advantages in using this method besides sort of giving you a nice understanding of things as a physicist. It's useful in teaching, as Maxwell. He talks not only about analogies, but drawing pictures. Okay? And he conceives of this all as part of being a scientist. This is part of the scientific pursuit. Okay? Now, finally, something he doesn't emphasize in this paper, and I think I know why, is that you may sometimes be in a situation where you can make analogical inferences, okay, between the analogy that you've constructed and the real thing, of which it is an analogy. You can say, okay, this holds in my analogical system, perhaps it holds in the real system as well. But then you'd have to have a close connection between the two systems. You'd have to be convinced that the analog system really does exist to make an analogical inference to what's going on in the real system. But Maxwell doesn't want to do that because he's dealing with an imaginary analog, not a real one. Okay. Okay, so that's the first paper I want to just mention briefly. If you had told Maxwell this is not scientific pursuit, he would laugh at you. This is important part of what he regarded as being reasonable science. The second paper I want to talk about was written in 1860, and he called it Illustrations of the Dynamical Theory of Gases, and now it's changed the subject to a discussion of why gases behave the way they do. In 1860, the various gas laws were known by physicists, and Maxwell said, look, these laws, we want to know why they hold. So his question was different from the electrical case. He didn't want to speculate in the electrical case. He wanted to speculate, however, in the molecular case. And he says so many of the known properties of gases can be explained using the hypothesis that gases are composed of, you know, minute particles, which he sometimes called particles, sometimes called molecules, that it becomes a subject of rational curiosity, I think those are his words, as to what's going on in these gases. Okay. So he says, look, I'm going to introduce some assumptions about molecules inside gases. And the assumptions were, in 1860, the assumptions were that the gases are composed of molecules which are in motion, tiny little things you can't see, and that these molecules interacted only at impact. There's no action at a distance here, or when they hit the sides of the container. And they obey, you know, Newton's laws of motion. Okay, and furthermore, they're spherical. And furthermore, they collide
when they do elastically, so no energy is lost. Okay. So he says, I'm going to work out this theory now. He calls it, unfortunately, I think, he calls it a physical analogy, just like he did in the electrical paper. But it's very different from the first paper in 1855. It's very different because Maxwell is actually supposing these things exist inside gases. That's a supposition, and he's going to use that supposition to explain why gases behave the way they do. And that is not the case in the electrical paper. He's not saying here's why electricity works the way it does, because it's composed of a fluid. Not a bit. Okay, so he works out various, using mathematics, he works out various results, which he puts in the form of, you know, problems to solve, in effect. And one problem to solve is how roughly, on the average, how far a gas molecule goes before it hits another one, called mean free path. And he worked out a general formula for this. His most important result in the paper, which bears his name, anybody know?
Displacement current?
What?
The displacement current?
No, not that. That's in electricity. Maxwell distribution law. He was interested in the distribution of molecular velocities inside of a gas, and so he made all kinds of assumptions, and he didn't justify any of them. Remember what I said at the beginning? He said so many of the properties of gases can be explained by the assumption that they consist of molecules, but. Okay, so what? That doesn't mean there are molecules. That doesn't mean there probably are. It just means that, hey, here's a theory, you know, that could, if it were true, explain these things, some of these things. So he then derives this law, which took his name, Maxwell distribution law of molecular velocities. And it is quite a, it's still taught today in, you know, physics courses, with Maxwell, Boltzmann improved on it and so on. But if you said to Maxwell, hey, Maxwell, now keep in mind Weinberg, if you said to Maxwell in 1860, how do you know that's true? He would have said, I don't know it's true. In fact, if you had said to Maxwell, what would verify that statement, this interesting law that you've introduced, he would have said, no, I don't know. Remember, 1860, it wasn't until 1927 that molecular beam experiments were done, which confirmed, generally speaking, Maxwell's distribution law. Okay. So Maxwell writes a letter, this was just before he published the paper, but he published an abstract of it. He writes a paper to Stokes in 1859. He says, well, here I've gotten some interesting results from molecular assumptions, even when I don't even know if there are any molecules. Okay. What do you think about this? Okay. So, what was he trying to do? What's the point of all this? Well, I think the point of this was to say, look, I've got a problem. I'm a mechanical philosopher. I believe, you know, the world consists of particles in motion, subject to Newtonian laws, and so on. And it would be very nice if I could use these assumptions to explain how gases behave. But how will I do this? I don't know. I have to work it out. In other words, the problem for Maxwell in 1860 is this problem. How is it possible to explain gaseous phenomena? The known laws, you know, Boyle's law, the ideal gas law, Gay-Lussac's law, and so on. How is it possible to explain these known phenomena using mechanical assumptions? Which presupposes the question, is it possible? All right. So, in the end, at the end of this paper, Maxwell says, well, you know, I've done some of this stuff. It's really, it's amazing, okay? But I've got some problems with the thing. First, I can't explain, my theory is inconsistent with certain known results. It's inconsistent with the ratio of specific heats of gases. It's too far off. It gives you a prediction that's too far off for Maxwell. And that was his deepest worry. Another worry was he can't explain why gases conduct electricity when they do. Okay? He couldn't do that. And he didn't try. So we called this part where he's mentioning all the problems he has, hitherto unconquered difficulties. I like that expression, hitherto unconquered difficulties. But he never said, uh-oh, my theory is refuted, you know, the way Popper would have. I mean, you know, he's got a conjecture up here and a refutation with the fact that specific heat ratio is well off. Okay. No, Maxwell did what, of course, physicists will do and said, okay, these are problems. I can't solve them all. I've got some interesting results here. I don't know whether they're true. That is, I don't know whether my assumptions are true. He made all kinds of assumptions, not just at the beginning of the paper, but throughout the paper to build up certain answers to the questions he was raising. And if you had asked him, how do you know that's so, Maxwell, he would have said, I don't. But it's a simple assumption to make. Let's see what happens. His paper satisfied his three desires. He's giving you an understanding of something. But it's not an understanding of how gases in fact behave, but it's an understanding of how they could behave if they were purely mechanical. It's the same thing, put it very simply, but with an analogy. The detective tries to solve the crime, and the detective says, well, let's see whether the butler did it. Okay. Well, then the first question is, well, how could the butler have done it? I mean, you know, the master of the house was much stronger than the butler. The master of the house was strangled. How would the butler get up there to strangle him? So he works out a theory. Not that the butler did it, but this is how it could have been done. Okay. Defense lawyers simply do this quite a bit when they defend their clients. Well, this is how it could have been done by someone else, not my client. Okay. A perfectly legitimate way to proceed, and exactly the way Maxwell did proceed. But again, you have to look carefully at what he was trying to explain. That is, how gases could behave mechanically, and give you some of the known results we get. Okay. Finally, let me turn to the third paper, which is, in some ways, the most interesting. It is a paper written in 1875. And it's called On the Dynamical Evidence of the Molecular Constitution of Bodies. Okay. And 1875. So the first paper was 1855. The next paper was 1860. And now it's 15 years later, 1875. And Maxwell, of course, is Maxwell, and he's become very, very famous, and the first Cavendish professor, and so on. And he really does believe there are molecules by this time, and he's writing articles again for the Encyclopedia Britannica, in which he says, "Here's why I'm justified in believing there are molecules." But in this paper of 1875. He says, let's see if I have any juicy quotes for you here. He says it toward the beginning of the paper, in attempting the extension of dynamical methods to the explanation of chemical phenomena, as a gas law, we have to form an idea of the configuration and motion of a number of material systems, each of which is so small that it cannot be directly observed. We have, in fact, to determine from the observed external actions of an unseen piece of machinery and its internal construction. Okay. And then he waxes philosophical. That is one of the reasons I really like Maxwell, because he's not afraid to tell you in philosophical terms what he's up to. The method which has been for the most part employed in conducting such inquiries is that of forming a hypothesis and calculating what would happen if the hypothesis were true. If these results agree with the actual phenomena, the hypothesis is said to be verified, so long at least as someone else does not invent another hypothesis which agrees still better with the phenomena. So Maxwell is rejecting what, you know, is known as the hypothetico-deductive method. Have your hypothesis, deduce some results from it. Same thing that Hempel was talking about in philosophy of natural science, the Semmelweis hypothesis, deduce consequences, go out and test them, and if they test right, then you're probably right. He says, he's going to introduce a new method. So the first method was the method of physical analogy. The second method, which I call, using his term, an exercise in mechanics. And the third method, he himself calls a method of physical speculation. He says, when examples of this method of physical speculation have been properly set forth and explained, we shall have fewer complaints of the looseness of reasoning of men of science, and the method of inductive philosophy will no longer be derided as mere guesswork. Okay. Well, Maxwell doesn't spell out what the method is. You have to read the paper to see what he does. And what he does is interesting. Unlike the other two papers, the other two methods, he starts by giving you some reason for thinking that gases, he's interested in that, may be composed of molecules. Okay. And he talks about various experiments that have been done, though he doesn't tell you anything about them. There were experiments done in the middle of, at the end of the 18th century and to disconfirm the caloric theory of heat, where heat is a substance. So heat is a substance or it's not. And if it's not, what is it? Well, in the middle of the 19th century, there were experiments done to show that heat is connected with work, mechanical work or energy. Okay. So Maxwell thinks that these experiments done by Joule show that that heat must be a form of energy. And Maxwell wrote a book called Theory of Heat. And in which he goes and tells you something about this. He says, well, there's two kinds of energy, potential energy, kinetic energy. And he gives you reasons for thinking it's not potential energy, so it must be kinetic energy. Well, if it's kinetic energy, which is producing the heat, then it's energy of motion. So there must be something in motion in the fluid, in the gas. Well, we don't see anything. Gas can heat up without boiling, and you don't see anything moving, so there must be something inside the gas which is moving, something you don't see. And this kind of warms you up a bit, you know. Mm-hmm. It gives you some reason for thinking, hey, at least Maxwell thought it did, some, as I put it, independent warrant, independent from the theory itself, from giving you some reason to think that gases are composed of particles in motion, and the bigger the motion, the bigger the heat. He also thinks, and here I would not go along with him, but he does. He thinks this is true. Look, mechanical theories, he says, have worked so well in astronomy. Yeah, and he says in electrical science, well, not so well. But Maxwell, of course, thought that the electric field could be understood in terms of a mechanical explanation, which he was never quite successful in giving. Give him that. This is his line, that dynamical theories work well in these other areas. So he thought some inductive reason to suppose that they're going to work well here. And then he finally gives a very interesting claim about mechanical explanations. He claims mechanical explanations are absolutely fundamental. And he doesn't spell out in great detail, but there's a well-known passage from Maxwell, and he says, when you can understand a phenomenon in terms of particles in motion subject to forces, then you have understood it completely. There is nothing left to understand. And it's sort of like that's the meaning of understanding in physics. All right. So he's giving you this methodological, whatever, semantical reason for thinking that molecular theory is a good thing to have here. So that's what I call the independent warrant part of the argument, that there is some reason to think that these basic assumptions are true. Then he does what he does before. He gives you not in the greatest detail, but he gives you what I call this theoretical development, mathematical development of the theory. But this time, he does it more in an interesting way. He says, look, I'm not going to start with any assumption about the shape of the molecules. And I'm not going to start with any assumption about that they just interact only at contact. No such thing. I'm going to take a nice equation, which was proved by Clausius in the 1850s, I think. It's in a situation where you have particles, observable particles, subject to forces in a confined to a whatever. And he takes this equation, which relates the pressure and the volume and the kinetic energy of the particles to the forces between the particles. This is an equation which he then applies to the molecules in a gas. And he shows you how from this general Clausius Sibirial equation, how he can derive a lot of stuff about gases. It's very interesting. He was presenting this to, I think, a more general audience, and this was a neat way to do it for him. But again, you know, it's not that he made great advances by 1875. He has these unconquered difficulties, this specific heat difficulty, the electrical conductivity of gases he can't explain. He's just got a new way of presenting these old ideas, but he also has some arguments in favor of the molecular theory, which he regards as empirical arguments, or one is in terms of the basic nature of mechanical explanations. Okay, so again, however, he has no proof. Okay. So he's at a sort of an intermediate stage here. He makes these speculations, method of physical speculation. It's a physical thing. He's not just giving you mathematical formulas. He's spelling it out, and he has some reason to think that his assumptions are true. Okay. So he satisfied some conditions here. He's giving you a physical understanding of the phenomena. He's spelling it out mathematically. Well, those are two conditions, spelling it out and doing so mathematically. And it gives you, again, an understanding, this time, you know, a realistic understanding from the form of this is the way how things probably are. But it's not proof. So, thinking about these things, I'm much more sympathetic to Feynman. Not Feynman, to Weinberg. Feynman's another matter. Feynman didn't like philosophers. Weinberg is in between there. Weinberg, I will tell you this final story. Weinberg wrote an article on scientific explanation, What Can Science Explain, for the New York Review of Books, I don't know, a bunch of years ago. And he, in the second or third paragraphs, he said, well, you know, what do I mean by explanation? And he says, I looked at the philosophers of science, and they're terrible, he says. They can't tell me. There's four exceptions. There's four exceptions that I think are okay. I felt terrific. I was one of the exceptions he mentioned. But then I looked at the other three, all of whom I'd criticized, myself, and so I was wondering, well, maybe I'm in the wrong company here. I don't know. But anyway, Weinberg is skeptical in general of philosophers. But I'm more sympathetic to where he is now, because these guys who say, you know, it's not scientific activity unless there's proof or unless there's a glimmer of how to prove this thing, unless you tell me the kinds of experiments I would need to do it, that's not science, that's speculation. Well, here you have Maxwell, and he's not giving you proof at all. He's developed this analogy, which is in 1855, which is an imaginary fluid subject to imaginary laws. In 1860, he has no experiments whatever, no empirical argument in favor of molecules, and he develops mathematically, using mathematics, he develops a bunch of theorems, including his famous, extremely important Maxwell distribution law. And then in 1875, he gives you some reasons for thinking, some empirical reasons, some methodological reasons, but again, no proof. And what strikes me is that this is perfectly okay. I mean, it's perfectly okay to work on these. It's perfectly scientific to try to figure out how gases could behave if they were going, mechanically, if we were going to explain the gas law. It's perfectly legitimate to work on this analogy that he did in 1855, but he has no theory of electricity at all. And suppose it doesn't pay off during your lifetime. Right? Suppose it doesn't. I mean, that's what Weinberg said. We're not going to get experimental proof during my lifetime, he said, of string theory. It's still a worthwhile scientific project. So despite the eminence of William Whewell, or my characterization of William Whewell, given my characterization of William Whewell and certainly of Hempel in the Philosophy of Natural Science book, I am more Maxwellian than I am Whewellian, or Hempelian. Okay, thanks.
Anyway, plenty of time for questions. Thanks. Wayne?
Thank you. That was wonderful. And I personally think we should all strive to be Maxwellian. I wonder how Maxwellian, though, the string theorists are. Because, there are important differences, it seems. Like their complacency about empirical evidence has turned into pride that the theory could be reconciled with anything that could possibly be observed. And that's regarded as a good thing by the string theorists. Whereas Maxwell, with the gases, at least he was able to make some connections with known laws, like the idea of gas law. And I'm trying to remember, but you mentioned the mean free path. Wasn't there a calculation of the rate of diffusion from some other part?
There were calculations. He made a calculation of molecular speeds.
Okay.
And he gave us his theoretical calculations. Okay. But, of course, this was under very idealized assumptions.
Right.
A very undense gas, very thin, density very low. So he told you how many meters per second this thing would, these various gas molecules would go, and assuming, of course, no collisions and so forth. So, but there was no way that he had to measure this at all. He didn't seem to get to be worried about this.
But it's something that he thinks that really ought to be done and wants to strive for. But
well, Maxwell has a passage, and I wrote it down, and I cannot find it now, and I want to publish it, but I'm in trouble. He said, we do what we can when we can, in science, and. He says the pioneers of science, that's his expression, the pioneers of science, namely himself, are frequently not in the position to verify their results. They don't know how to do it. But that's not a great drawback. He says, of course we want proof when we can get it. but often we can't. And that doesn't mean we should stop doing what we're doing. That's his line, okay? Yeah.
There's another passage in that 1875 paper, there or somewhere else, I might be misremembering, which I really like, because in a way it's kind of prophetic, because he essentially says, you know, what we really like is what we would now call agreeing measurements of Avogadro's number from different phenomena.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
He's actually saying what we
he
what
did not have that, right.
He didn't have that, but he says, you know, what we should, what we'd like to have is exactly what Perrin did a little while later.
Sure. Yeah. He'll tell you where to go.
Yeah, he's telling you what to look for.
You bet.
There,
you bet.
That.
Yeah. Oh, right. All right. I'm not going to talk very much about string theory tomorrow, but I'll talk a little bit about it. Yeah.
I wanted one of the things that I was struck and delighted by in the past in your book and your discussion of the third method was this that you didn't bring was the kind of, the second method with the initial step of the gases where they're round molecules.
Yeah.
You said that's just showing physically that it's possible to have that kind of explanation. But after this step of the viral theorem where the attraction could be at all sorts of things
right.
And where it gets up, it's much more general.
Yeah.
And you're getting this neat mathematical way of doing it. He has that you're now thinking of it as plausible, but you're still not in a position where you would even, I mean, as we were saying, as Wayne and you were saying, this, he says some more about the sort of things that could get you to accepting it. But he had a neat way of talking about this third, characterizing this third, where it's now plausible.
Yeah.
And
I think it's more than plausible, he thinks. If you read other stuff that he wrote at the time,
okay.
He says, look, I think I'm right, but I can't prove it.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, that's delving into his psyche, but he actually says things like that. Yeah. The first one, you got the theory feed there. Okay. The first one, the paper, is it plausible? It's possible.
That's right. Merely possible.
It's possible.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's the detective saying it's possible.
Right.
The butler did it because here's the way he could have done it. Yeah.
And the thing about the further thing you're exploring, in the merely possible, now you've got these problems, this ratios of specific heats, but in the second paper, those are like proposed further research that will get you the way to put it all together or. That when you get it, it's going to provide.
Maxwell says, look, we've got to get inside molecules. I can't do that now.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So to figure out the electrical properties of molecules. Well, not for me.
Yeah. No, I think.
Yeah.
Okay, next, Elliot.
Thanks. I was wondering if physical analogies from Maxwell constitute something pre-scientific or whether they're in fact produced scientific knowledge. And I'm thinking about John Locke. And that for him, the chief virtue for mechanical analogies is that they're intelligible, but they don't actually produce real knowledge. They can extend our insight into things, but it doesn't actually produce real knowledge, and therefore doesn't actually produce scientific knowledge.
Yeah.
So
okay.
The status
okay.
For him.
Good. Look, how would Maxwell respond to you? Okay, that's what you know. I'm trying to put my head inside Maxwell's. Maxwell will say, of course, in the end, we want, as you put it, real scientific knowledge. But science doesn't always give us that, you know. And there's a long path to get there. And so the analogies don't give us knowledge of what causes electricity to operate the way it does. But it gives us a kind of knowledge of the laws. That is, you get more familiar with. Maybe in mid-19th century, scientists may well have been more familiar with hydrodynamics than they were with electricity. So if I can, you know, give you an analog here in terms of water flowing through a pipe, or not water, some imaginary crazy fluid flowing through a pipe, that might help you understand what you're talking about when you talk about, you know, electricity flowing through a wire. It may not, but Maxwell thought it could. Is that scientific knowledge? Well, if it is, great. If it's not, who cares? Okay? I think that's Maxwell's attitude. We do what we can, and Maxwell could do it better than the rest of us. Okay? That's the deal.
I have a cue, but I'm going to jump in. And I wanted to ask you about, several times you said that Maxwell gives us an understanding in these papers with his physical analogies.
Yeah. You talking about just the physical analogy or the other two papers?
Well, you said it sort of for all three, I thought.
Yeah, he gives a different kind of understanding for each one. Yeah.
So what's the kind of understanding when you really don't think that the explanation you're offering could be truth-like, or, you know,
could be truth-like or is truth-like?
Let's start with could be.
Could be. Yeah, look, it's what Maxwell does in the second paper, that is, in the 1860 paper. He says, look, this is how gases could be. If they were like this, then we could explain various gas laws. I don't know that they are this way. I'm not going to say that they are. I'm not going to say that they're not. But this gives you a possible understanding of the way gases behave. Mm-hmm. Okay, and of what causes gases to behave that way. So you have to look at the question you're raising. The question Maxwell is raising is, what is causing the gas laws to be the way they are? Okay, how do you give a physical cause of these phenomena? In the first paper, he's not asking about what's causing electricity. So the question is, well, you know, what are these electrical phenomena? It's a more general question. I'm I will give you an analogy which will help you to understand what they are. Okay, it's not exactly the bare thing, but it's the same kind of question with Whewell. I want a way of conceptualizing the data. All right, here's a way, barren tree.
Okay. Even if you don't really think it could be a bear,
that's a possibility. That's what Whewell says. You run through, if you're a scientist, you run through various possibilities. Whewell doesn't tell you how you get them. It's, you know, whatever it is. These possibilities occur to you, and then somehow we're built into us. We have some mechanism for picking out one that, you know, is worth looking at. Okay, mm-hmm. Worth testing. There's different ways of understanding things. There's different questions. I mean, my notion of explanation is that, you know, you explain by, in terms of answering a question to a certain problem. So you have to specify what the problem is. What are you trying to do? And Maxwell very nicely tells you what he's trying to do in each of these papers, what kind of understanding he's trying to provide. In the third paper, it's, well, now I think I'm on the right track, and I'll give you some reasons for thinking that maybe you too to understand gaseous behavior in terms of tiny things hitting each other.
Okay, Steph is the next.
Can I try to reconcile the Whewellian approach with the Maxwellian? As, you know, I think you presented them as if it was either or. Either you do it like Whewell or Hempel, or you do it like Maxwell. And it seems to me it could be argued that Maxwell's three papers and a few other that he published using physical analogies, what if things were that way, speculations and things like that, were means to construct a theory, a heuristics. So unlike Whewell, he wouldn't jump to a theory, but ultimately he would like to have a theory. And he went for the theory of electricity and magnetism in the treatise, which was supposed to be a unified theory, supported by all these mechanical analogies, the pulleys and things like that. But ultimately he would like to construct a theory, but he couldn't jump to a theory without exploring analogies and various other heuristic devices to do that. And in the end, it seems to me, he would very much like to have the theory tested. And there was an issue, actually, there is an issue, what is Maxwell's theory? And Maxwell's equations were actually he decided, or whoever who. Okay. But there was an issue of actually developing his insights into a theory by himself and by the so-called Maxwellians.
Yeah,
and he wanted to, by Hertz and things like that.
Yeah, no, absolutely. He wanted to develop a mechanical theory.
Yeah.
And so that some of the critics say, well, Maxwell's theory is simply his equation. That's it.
Yeah.
No mechanical theory. Yes, look. You can, if you want,
reconcile them in the way you suggest. Hewell, I mean, I believe Hewell, I'm going to say this, Hewell was probably a teacher of Maxwell. Whether, you know, Maxwell learned a lot from him, I don't know. Maxwell is faced with the following problem. Of course, in the end, I want to develop a full theory that's testable and tested and right. That's what I want. But there's a long way to the end. I'm frustrated. And I read Newton tells me, don't do this. Don't speculate. Hypotheses non fingo, says Newton. And then violates it by giving you hypotheses and Principia even. But that's crazy. There are lots of things I can do, and I'm very curious, okay? So I'm gonna try to do them. And I think he would say to Hewell, look, you're oversimplifying what scientists do tremendously. You make it sound in your philosophy of the inductive sciences as if, you know, there's two stages, which is what Hewell says there is. Two stages, the discovery stage, where you think up ideas which may or may not be true. The mind, this is, for Hewell, the most important stage, because it's the genius, the guy who thinks elliptical orbit or gravitational attraction, or, you know, and then the testing of it. And Maxwell is saying, slow down. There's lots of activities along the way which are very scientific and can be done, you know, by various scientists, especially by people of the rank of James Clerk Maxwell, I'm not overly worried. Don't tell me that I haven't proved my theory. So what? Of course, as I say in this quote, which I can't find the origin of, he says, of course, there'll be many periods in science where you don't have the proof, but you still work, and this is what you do. Indeed, you can draw the analogy, you can give the possibilities, you can do this, and perhaps there are other strategies. I call them just Maxwellian strategies for approaching a scientific problem. Perfectly legitimate strategy. That's what I conclude from this, yeah. Yeah, but no, I think you're absolutely right. In the end, Maxwell, just like string theory. I'm not gonna make a speculation. They want, at least the people in the audience, the physicists in the audience, said, where's the proof? Okay, so I think that's always a question.
Martin? Thank you. So I have a question along similar lines. So it was unclear to me really if there is such a tension between Hewell's approach and Maxwell's approach. So when you're talking about Hewell's method, he's interested in confirming a hypothesis and co-legation is a part of this process, and resilience is a part of this process.
Yeah.
And so if that's what Hewell's doing on the one hand, and your discussion of Maxwell has to do more with strategies for doing science that may not lead to the truth of some hypothesis, but really just trying to work on these problems and different methods for kind of getting through the problems that are at hand. If they're not really, the two approaches aren't really trying to do the same thing, is there really a tension? Couldn't they both be okay with each other's work, given that they're aimed at different ends?
Well, what worries me here is that Hewell is not only, he's describing two things, what science does, what scientists do, and what they should do. And the same thing in Hempel's brief discussion. That, you know, if you're going to be doing science, then you've got to come up with the ideas which would at least potentially explain so on, and then you got to test them. And if you haven't done both, you haven't done true science. That's the sort of idea you get. Now, maybe Hewell would deny that, maybe Hempel would deny that, I don't know. But the smell is in the air, okay? That's what you sort of come away with. Now remember, Hempel is attacking the so-called simple inductivist. He says you start with observations and then you make the induction, and no, this is the wrong method, says. Or you think of Newton. Okay, Newton makes you think that, again, you start with the observation, what he called the phenomena, okay, which are, you know, results of, in the case of gravity, the results of telescopic observations of the motions of the various known planets and their moons. And then you make a causal inference to the forces or the force operated to produce these effects. And then you generalize like mad inductively, and there you got it, your proof. And then to really put the icing on the cake, you show how, in the method of synthesis, you show how your whole law or set of laws can explain other phenomena and so on. And that's the way you really present science. Now, if Newton was saying only, look, this is the way you prove something in science, this is the method of proof, then Maxwell, you know, okay, he wouldn't have a problem with that. But somehow he would have a problem definitely with, this is what you do. And remember, Newton said, and this is what you have to do real science. Okay? And Maxwell says, no, you don't. Okay.
Kezo?
First, I would like to challenge that Wayne's claim that string theorists don't care about experiments at all. I think is not true. I think it's very much eagerly wanted. So I think everyone would say that. And especially, I mean, there's some truth to it, because I think after the case with the landscape, when they show they can find basically 10 to the 500 different kinds of vacuums with different kind of low energy physics, that becomes a little bit like that. Well, it becomes a theory of anything and things like that. So that becomes more popular. But prior to that, the hope was very much that there would be just a few vacuum states. And if it was just a few of them, and one of them perfectly reproduced the particle masses and all the charges and everything, that would be really good evidence, even in the absence of new empirical data. And I think that would be quite fair. Now it's much more complicated due to this, and many people find this to be hugely problematic. So it's not like everyone says, well, we can explain everything. So I think it's much of a controversy, and even the ones that try to kind of defend this via some anthropic principles eagerly want to find some way of connecting this to experiments. I think it's a little bit of a caricature the way you present that.
And what I said was, some of them take it as a virtue that it can that it can be reconciled with anything, and that is true. I didn't say all.
Okay,
well, at least at Hopkins,
that was just an aside.
At Hopkins, they would agree with you, yeah. They're very skeptical of string theory for this reason.
My point was not so much to be skeptical with string, to defend that they actually do try to find experiment. But then I was trying to compare this with kind of a recent book by Rick and David that actually tried to defend the method used in string theory and the scientific methods, where he eagerly tried to argue that there can be good theoretical reasons to trust the theory prior to the empirical evidence.
Right.
I think it overstates this a little bit and is a little bit too optimistic. But would you basically say that this is one of and he also, of course, agrees with and that it would be better with empirical evidence, and that's obvious. So is this thing of the Maxwellian picture you were saying, it's also something that says that we can have good theoretical reasons to believe in a new theory prior to new empirical data?
Yes, it gets tricky.
Because
Maxwell rejects the hypothetical deductive method completely. Mm-hmm. So he is not going to tell you that, look, because your theory can explain a lot of different facts, that's evidence in favor of theory, not at all. He's going to reject that idea. He wants, he calls it inductive evidence, I guess. So in that way, he's more like Newton. Unlike Newton, he's going to say, look, it's okay in fact, it's required to theoretically develop your theory and show how it could explain all these various things without inferring from that that it's probably true. Because there may be other theories which you have to show that can't be the case, that could equally explain the data. That's his line. So,
the theoretical arguments he gives are not arguments for the truth of his theory. That's the line I'm taking. They're not arguments for anything. The derivation he gives for the Maxwell distribution law is not an argument that the Maxwell distribution law is true. It's just seeing what the hell I can do with it. Okay, that's the line. It's I don't know how many of you have ever heard Richard Feynman on TV. I watched him on TV. There was a great interview on the BBC where he's such a terrific talker that they cut out the questioner. So you don't hear the question, and you just hear the answer. And he's talking about his, whatever it is, his life and how, whatever he did in quantum electrodynamics and so on. But he says about the early part of his life when he was at Cornell University, and I think Maxwell would have liked this. When he was at Cornell University, he used to eat with the students in the student cafeteria. And one day, the students started a food fight in the student cafeteria, and they started throwing food at each other. And then it escalated. They started throwing plates at each other. Okay. And what Feynman noticed was the wobble of the plates as they flew through the air. And so he went back to his room, and he was assistant professor at his office, and he said, can I derive this from Newtonian mechanics, the wobble? And he spent a couple of days actually doing it, and he got the result. He did get it. And he's so proud of it that he goes to the Nobel Prize physicist at Yale time, Hans Bethe, and he shows Bethe this tremendous result he got. And Bethe looks at this and says, Feynman, you are an idiot. You're wasting your time. This is no value whatever. And Feynman was really crestfallen. I mean, he's a young guy coming out, young genius. So he goes to the chairman of the physics department, whose name I don't know, chairman looks at it. He can't make head or tail of it. And he says, Feynman, he says, you're a genius. You work on anything you want. Okay. And I think that's the attitude that Maxwell had here. He wants to work on these issues. They're valuable. They're interesting to him. And you'll probably get interested, too. And if you get some interesting results, so much the better. That's the attitude I think Maxwell had. Again, it's my hero, Maxwell. So.
I wanted to make a small difference with you about Newton, but that isn't really the point of it. I don't think it's right to say that Newton was telling you not to use hypotheses. He was suggesting that they had a certain use, and the one use that they don't have is as an argument against any kind of inductive reasoning.
Okay.
That they're not, when he says they're not to be regarded, he doesn't mean they're not to be employed. He means they're not to be. It's a question of their relative standing.
Like hypotheses have no place in experimental philosophy. How do you deal with that? I mean, I'm going to agree with you, but that's what he says.
He says lots of things about them, including what they're good for, right? Suggesting experiments.
Yeah. Look. I think the way I would understand Newton is, I think what you're suggesting. Newton is not saying don't ever use hypotheses, because he uses them. What I take him to be saying, and Bill, you can tell me I'm way off base, but what I take him to be saying is that just because you have derived something true from a hypothesis doesn't mean the hypothesis is true. It doesn't mean it's even probable. Okay, but yes, hypotheses can be useful in some way.
But he's saying more than that, right? He's saying that a wild inductive extension, like universal gravitation, has a better standing than a hypothesis that goes against it. And in particular, the failure of his theory to live up to standards of mechanical intelligibility can't be held against it, because you can't reject the argument for universal gravitation because...
You mean mechanical in terms of no contact, I mean only contact forces. Okay.
Right, the kind of mechanical analogy that's something like what Maxwell was doing. But Maxwell is doing it in a much more, in a spirit informed by Newton, right? So that eventually Maxwell gives us the Maxwell theory, right, which makes all these phenomena intelligible without regard to whether they're intelligible on that level.
On which level?
On the level of mechanical processes that explain why Maxwell...
Well, Maxwell was deeply worried about this. He was deeply worried about giving you electrical theories without mechanical explanation for what's going on here.
Right.
He never solved that problem.
Somewhat worried about that, right? But he understood...
He died too young, yeah.
He understood it as two different things. Right?
But going back to your question about Newton, I think that the way Newton should have put it is just that he doesn't accept the hypothetical deductive method. Period. Of course, you develop hypotheses. In fact, he's got a section on in the latter part of the book 3 where he shows you how the theory of gravity can explain various things like the tides. So he's in favor of explanations all over the place. But if you're going to prove something, then you need to show, you need to give inductive support for the laws that you're giving. Now, in Rule 4, which I think you may be referring to, of the four rules of Newton, he says, look, the fact, so he's got his law of gravity, let's say, and he inductively, makes an inductive generalization like mad from the fact that all the planets and their satellites obey the law of gravity, everything does. And what Newton says in Rule 4 is that the mere fact that you, Descartes, can imagine a contrary hypothesis is no reason for me to think that my hypothesis has any less support. You have to present some inductive reason for thinking your contrary hypothesis is true, okay? So he rejects the use of hypotheses as a way of criticizing the proposition that you've induced from experiments. That's, a no-no for Newton. You can't be Descartes and imagine, hey, the world might have been different and looked the same way, okay? You can't do that. That's no argument against my theory. So yeah.
I was suggesting that combining that, Maxwell also understood that the theory that he had of the electrodynamic field, the electromagnetic field, is a theory that stands on its own because it embraces in an intelligible framework this wide area of phenomena in much the same way that universal gravitation does, while at least setting aside, let's say, the demand for mechanical intelligibility had a lot of heuristic uses, but isn't really a requirement.
That mechanical explanations are not really a requirement?
Right.
1875, he writes, how do you explain that? That he writes this thing that to explain something in effect means to give a mechanical explanation.
I'm just saying that you can present a theory and say that it makes all these phenomena intelligible and say, well, for the moment we don't understand. But that doesn't, we don't understand it on this level.
We don't understand what, the theory or the phenomena?
The phenomena. We don't understand the phenomena on this level, but we still have a theory.
Why don't we understand the phenomena?
Because we don't have a mechanical explanation.
Oh, we have a theory which, does pretty well for us, but we don't understand because there's no mechanical explanation. Is that what you're saying?
Right, but the theory has its own empirical basis.
Yeah, I don't think Maxwell would worry about that, sure. But he wants truth. Maxwell's a realist. He wants to know what's really there. He's not an instrumentalist.
I was just suggesting this as a kind of a really serious difference between the Maxwell's field theory of electromagnetism and Newton's theory of gravitation.
on the one, both of those on the one hand, and string theory.
You mean Maxwell's equations?
Yeah.
You don't mean his mechanical theory.
Right.
Okay,
right,
Maxwell.
Right. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Sorry. That's okay, yeah.
Yes.
Has the Maxwellian moment passed? I think of his gentlemanly activity, delivering the paper to the Philosophical Society. And then I jump ahead to the controversies over quantum mechanics and the entanglement, where it becomes a blood sport. The culture of science seems to have changed irrevocably.
That's interesting. Uh-huh. Yeah.
How was, what was the reception was of his paper?
That's a good question.
See, it's 1855,
yeah.
1855.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. I mean, so
maybe Bill can.
Well, I just, this is following up on it. I just, I mean, in that Faraday's lines of force, I mean, one of the things that is, was so impressive was he actually developed a new mathematics that the our concept of a modern electromagnetic field, but abstract mathematical field theory. Maxwell developed that in the course of getting the way of putting together all those Faraday's things Faraday discovered and putting them together. And of course, we think of now Maxwell's equations sort of giving a basic summary. And that is, independently of, I mean, his attempts to look for a field waving, you know, the ether and the stuff like that. There, this thing, just that he did it. There's a lot. It's. I think it's this mathematical structure gives you a way of making it useful, because
mm-hmm.
you can put together all kinds of relations. And it also turns out, even at that level, before you, that it was challenged. But the alternative theories were kind of Newtonian action at a distance accounts of electromagnetic phenomena. And there was a big controversy that, like, even after he had the book, there was, and it was finally, I think it was Hertz, wasn't it, who provided a real, finally, empirical support
mm-hmm.
that supported the, even at this level, the Maxwell version against these action at a distance theories. And I think it's anyway, I just wanted to.
Yeah, thanks.
Can I just put though to that? I mean, part of the insistence on mechanical models is opposition to the action at a distance model,
right.
Because he's convinced from the whole Faraday time that the dynamics in between two charges, right, or in general between two magnetic sources, is an important thing, and that Faraday's experiment suggested that, right? And that, you know, that's what sort of, that's what you wouldn't have in the case of gravity, right?
That's getting complicated.
Yeah, I think we better cut that line and give one more student question
okay.
back, Craig.
Okay.
Yeah.
This is very much along the lines of what Robert was saying. It strikes me that you're being slightly unfair to Newton on the issue of, you know, contact and mechanism, and that his dialectic is really with people who think that in order for your theory to be intelligible, you must give us, you know, a mechanism that involves, you know, actual touching of bodies.
You're speaking about Newton or Maxwell?
Yeah, I'm talking about Newton.
Yeah.
And to say that he therefore would have a problem with what Maxwell was doing, I think is not quite right. And insofar as Maxwell is not requiring that this is, you know, this is a necessary condition for a theory to be intelligible, right? It's just, this is just turns out to be...
Not the theory to be intelligible, but the phenomena to be intelligible, is what Maxwell says. You don't really understand, in this very strong passage, you really don't understand the phenomena unless you understand it in terms of a mechanical theory. And he says forces, you know, whatever. He doesn't tell you what kind of forces, but...
What did he think then of gravity? Was it not intelligible?
Gravity involves a force. He didn't tell you in this passage what forces he's talking about. And, of course, you know, there are different views on what counts as mechanical philosophy, right? I mean, when Boyle introduced the term, he didn't introduce forces. He just had motion, bodies in motion, interacting in some way. Newton himself was, of course, deeply worried about action at a distance. As to whether there really is such a thing. And in fact, he denies it, but he doesn't have a way of explaining it. Okay. But I don't think the term mechanical philosophy changes in its usage over
the... That's the thing that's bothering me, is I feel like there's a shift between, you know, the Cartesian way of theorizing and Maxwell.
Oh, absolutely.
And you're putting Newton against Maxwell, and he needs...
Well, I'm putting Newton for purposes of the talk. Sure. Why not?
All right. Thanks for a wonderful session.
Yeah, thank you.